Hello and thanks for joining me. 2018 is the 100th anniversary of the birth of Leonard Bernstein, the famous 20th century American composer and conductor. And the Kennedy Center in Washington, D.C. has been doing a series of events commemorating this 100th anniversary, I guess, of his birth. And so part of that effort was a production of Candide by Leonard Bernstein. I saw this production on May 12th down at the Kennedy Center, performed by Washington National Opera. I'm not going to read through the entire cast, but you can see the cast there. Our main cast, Candide, was sung by Alex Schrader. Cunegonde was sung by Emily Podoraic. The Old Lady was sung by Denise Graves. And Pangloss was sung by Wynn Harmon. Our conductor was Nicole Payment. I hope I'm pronouncing that somewhat correctly. And the director was Francesca Zambello. Once again, there is the cast. If you want to put it on pause, you can see the complete cast. But yeah, Candide by Leonard Bernstein, based on the novella, the 18th century novella by Voltaire. And it has a sort of complicated production history. So I wrote it down because it was kind of detailed. So originally in 1953, Lillian Hellman approached Leonard Bernstein about making adapting a musical play from Candide, and he thought that was, I think, a really good idea. This was sort of in reaction to the House Un-American Activities Committee, the whole McCarthy era of the time, because Candide, you know, explores, I think, this idea of authoritarianism and a person's experience during, you know, a difficult times. So he thought it was a good idea, but a couple of years went by, and before it actually hit Broadway, it premiered on Broadway in 1955. It wasn't a complete, you know, success. From the notes here, it ran for only 73 performances on Broadway, and then in 1959, they tried it out in London, where it went for 60 performances. Then it was performed off and on, you know, over the years after that, but it didn't really get any traction until the 1973. It was adapted again. It was revised and for Broadway, and it was a success, and it ran for a couple of years. That version from 1973 is known as the Chelsea version. And then there was another version in 1982, which is called the Opera House version, which played at New York City Opera and some other, you know, fairly well-known opera houses. And then in 1999, there was a production, another version from the Royal National Theater version. And then this version that I saw in Washington is a new version. The version that I saw is by new version by John Caird, lyrics by Richard Wilbur, you know, in addition to other folks who contributed to the lyrics that I read earlier. So it has sort of a complicated, I think, production history. And this was, a relatively new version. This was premiered at Glimmerglass, the Glimmerglass Festival, maybe a couple of years ago. And that was the production that was shown here in Washington National Opera. So what it's about is, really, it's about optimism. Candide is this person of, you know, not noble birth, sort of a commoner, I guess. And he actually ends up falling in love with Cunegonde, who's the daughter of a baron and baroness. And so he kind of starts trying to woo her. Well, once the baron and baroness gets wind of this, of course, they kick him out of the castle. He sort of is at loose ends. He gets swept up and recruited for the army for Bavaria. This originally took place in Westphalia, where he started out. So he's in the army in Bavaria. Bavaria and Westphalia wind up having a war. And so he thinks that Cunegonde, her brother Maximilian, as well as the Baron and Baroness, have all been killed. But he winds up in Holland, where he meets up again with his mentor, Pangloss, and his tutor, sort of teacher, mentor Pangloss has this philosophy of optimism where, you know, everything works out for the best. You know, there's a divine order. The universe is ordered. So whatever happens, happens for a reason. And so that's his philosophy, this sort of philosophy of optimism. You know, but then there's a lot of twists and turns that we end up getting. Candide finds out that the castle, he thinks that everybody's been killed back in Westphalia, but as it turns out, Cunegonde was not killed. She was sold to a man in Lisbon, Portugal, and that man was sharing her with a cardinal. I think maybe the Grand Inquisitor, if I remember that correctly. But anyway, the Inquisition is going on at this time too. So Candide ends up winding up down in Portugal, in Lisbon, and has a run-in with these men and ends up killing them, rescues, I guess, Cunegonde from that, and then they flee to Spain, where they run into more trouble and more problems. There's an earthquake in there. I think that was when they were still in Lisbon. They wind up deciding they need to immigrate to the New World. He and Cunegonde get separated again in Montevideo, Uruguay, and then the governor of Uruguay or Montevideo takes an interest in Cunegonde. She sort of winds up, I guess, with him as his mistress or whatever. Candide and his friend, whose name is Cacambo, wind up in El Dorado, you know, the mythical city El Dorado, where it's like a utopia, except it's not a utopia for Candide because he doesn't have Cunegonde. So he ends up finding a new friend, Martin, while Cacambo goes to try to find meet up again with Cunegonde. They all decide to meet up again in Venice through a lot of machinations and sort of unlikely plot twists. They actually do meet up in Venice, and then they decide, Candide decides they need to go, they're just going to go buy a little plot of land somewhere in the north of Italy and settle down and just lead a calm life. And the ending is called Making Your Garden Grow. There's a song there at the very end called Make Our Garden Grow. So, you know, just sort of, you know, stay put and take care of ourselves. So that's sort of the high level overview. Basically what it's showing us, though, I think, in my opinion, is showing us this, all these troubles, like, why do these bad things happen to these people? You know, if there's a order, to the universe, as the philosophy of his mentor Pangloss would say, you know, why is there so much suffering in the world? And there's actually a really cool quote here in the show notes, because we had a really nice article here in the notes by Jamie Bernstein, the daughter of Leonard Bernstein. So I thought I'd just read this paragraph because it sort of explains, I think, the philosophy of Candide. It says, Lillian Hellman was drawn, like Voltaire, to Candide's idiocy, but my father found himself leaning toward Candide's humanity. Pangloss's philosophy parodies Leibniz's insistence on God's perfection, but Candide interprets it as an assurance that all people mean well. That's a far more humanistic brand of optimism. And it speaks to Bernstein's fundamental crisis of faith, a crisis that can be tracked through his entire compositional output. His ongoing argument appears at first to be with God. If you're up there looking after us, how can you let all these terrible things happen to us down here? But in the end, the argument is really more with mankind itself. If we really have this divine spark, why are we so beastly to each other? My father wrestled with these questions all his life, and although Candide purports to be a musical comedy, those questions come up here as well. So yeah, musical comedy, that's some of my thoughts about the opera. Is it an opera? Is it an operetta? Is it a musical, you know, like a musical comedy? It really had elements to me of all three. There's some really difficult singing in it. There's an aria called Glitter and Be Gay, gay in the sense of happy, not so much sense in the sexual orientation. That's sung by Cunegonde. That is not would require an operatically trained singer to sing that, I think. So there's some singing in it that is definitely operatic and not musical, not so much maybe what we would expect from a Broadway musical. But then there, it does sort of have this Broadway feel to it. So it's sort of middle ground and really encompasses elements of all three: opera, operetta, and musical theater. So, I enjoyed it immensely. The music, the audience laughed. It was very funny. It was laugh out loud funny. The audience was really into it. Some really funny, amid all the seriousness of these terrible things happening to these characters, Candide is just such this optimist that he just never gives up. You know, he never gets terribly disillusioned. He just, he loves Cunegonde, and that's basically it. So even though misfortune befalls him, he stays pretty optimistic throughout, as do all the characters to some degree, even though they face a lot of hardships. So the ending, another thought about the ending, make our garden grow. You know, to me, this meant the ultimate happiness is found. Yes, there's misfortune in the world. Yes, a lot of it we have no control over. It's something that just happens. But what we can do is, you know, cultivate ourselves. We make our own garden grow. We tend to our own garden, and we just take care of that and let the rest of the universe take care of itself. That was sort of what I took away from that ending, song that the whole group sang, "Make Our Garden Grow." So yeah, I really enjoyed this opera a lot, or opera, operetta, musical theater a lot. I'm super glad that I got to see it. I had tried to listen to this, just listening to it without it being performed, and I couldn't really get into it until I saw it. Now I have a little better understanding, I think, of where it's coming from. The music in it is definitely very Bernstein music, you know, who also did West Side Story, music for West Side Story. So it's very very Bernstein, but very optimistic music, even in the face of the hardships that all the characters go through. So, I think I'll stop the chat with that. You know, about Voltaire's Candide, I have never read that. As fate would have it, I actually meant to bring the book. This week, after seeing Candide, I came across a used copy of Candide by Voltaire. So I will be reading Candide. It's a relatively short novella. Probably during my free reading period this year, I'm going to try to get it read in the coming weeks and months. So it'll be coming up. I'll do a book chat on it when I get it read. So my next opera, I have one more opera for the season this season, and it is The Barber of Seville. This was in my program from Candide, so this is the little handout. I do have that coming up in the next few days, so there will be an opera chat for that. So stay tuned. Take care. Bye.